freedom in knowing my life is better off in your hands. The past is gone, what's done is done. Now I'm alive, and I'm never gonna look back. I can never be free. Good evening. Welcome to Jesus Loves Lakeland and to Believers Fellowship Church. We're glad you're here. I'm glad I'm here. Would you stand? Let's worship the Lord together.
And with the crown. just welcome you, Father God. We welcome you. We welcome you into this place tonight, into our hearts. We welcome you, Holy Spirit. We welcome you. We welcome you. We welcome you. Have your way. Have your way in this church tonight. Have your way in us, in our hearts, in our minds tonight. Jesus. Here I am before you, falling in love, seeking your truth, knowing that your perfect grace has brought me to this place. Because of you, I freely live my life to you, oh God, I give. So I stand before you, God, and I lift my voice, 'cause you set me free. And I will shout out your name from the rooftops, I'll proclaim that I am yours, Jesus. Lift your hands to the Lord. Say, I'm yours. I'm yours, Jesus. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us. Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up. And all the world will praise your great name. Your great name, your great name. Lost or saved, they find their way at the sound of your great name.
All the world.
Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up. And all the world will praise your great name. Your great name. Your great name.
Can we just lift our hands and lift our voices and just pray in the Holy Ghost for a moment or so here? Come on, church. Pray like you got something. No soto shapara la vasivia mondo botombre vechiti alla lance bremi di vendia. Mende vetia sane le lembi di amna mondo io coscia tanne breve di vista tanne ne mende velele alla lavandia. Mosso bromo no mo combre vi divi sala la dande bre bende bre pia sotto shatai. Ninghi o pose dende anna na sande de vesa. Nenghi a su remana ma sam brevi di atala le dende ara da vassam mana davando. Mendia su revi sandi a shivre bosoko nengi di ala la vondi amna basso roto io so ti a shatala le andia hanem revi de mosa keni a pane venti ala la la masandia ne su cose pe fi ala la basse fi ada da bassa fa nisha da da bassi fi non goro bosso ramana basse fi ala la vondi a pane vecchi satala le andia. Nendi ashure vi divisa panda da manca da davanti vi chissa pedia de via. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Mende basso rivi chisse vedi a tambre vi divisa pala le andi bende vidende mondore manda massa paia. Sweet presence of Jesus. Holy Ghost, we're so glad you're here. I wouldn't want to be here if you weren't here. Lord, we thank you according to your word. You said where two or more are gathered, there you are in the midst. So you're right here. You're right here tonight. You're right here tonight. You're right here tonight. You've come to meet every need in the building, and you've come to meet many needs that aren't even here. You've come to fill us so that we can be used for the glories of God. Father, I thank you that tonight we begin a weekend of saturation. We begin a weekend of encounters that will change us forever. We honor your presence, Lord. And Lord, well, I thank you that you honor our presence. Those that have made the sacrifice or whatever, it's not much of a sacrifice for me. I'm so glad to be here. It's just a joy. But for those of us that have come, you'll honor us in our coming. Tonight, you'll do something in our lives. You'll do something for us. We thank you for it. We thank you for it. Thank you for it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now we have some guests and stuff here tonight. We're very glad you're here. We're very glad you're here. One of the things that our church has just recently come into is we are believing God for a great outpouring of the Holy Ghost in our city. In our city. And so that's why we've named this weekend Jesus Loves Lakeland. It just kind of makes it personal. So I know everybody in the city's not here, and I can't necessarily speak for everybody in the city, but my God can touch everybody in the city. So would you just for another moment, I know we've done some praying in the Holy Ghost, but if we prayed in the Holy Ghost for 4 hours tonight, it would be a wonderful thing. We won't do that, I don't think. That's not the plan. But would you just begin to pray over our city? Okay, Father, we pray over our city. We lift up our mayor and our city commissioners and all those people that sit on those boards, all those people that speak as to influence to them, our police chief, all the officers, our well, it's Polk County, but our school board, the superintendent, all the teachers within the city that touch the lives of the families that are in this city. We speak supernatural wisdom, even if they're not believers, Lord. You place those people into those positions, and you can use them by their very office, even if they are resistant to the move of the Holy Ghost. By their office, you can use them, Lord. So, Father, we thank you that you desire to do something big in the city of Lakeland. And we position ourselves, we posture ourselves to be used of the Holy Ghost, to bring revival, to bring change, to bring salvation, to bring healing, to bring deliverance, to bring the glories of God into this city, Lord. Father, we thank you that you've placed us here, not by accident, but you've placed us here on purpose. We live here. As long as I live here, Jesus will be glorified here. As long as we live here, Jesus will be glorified here. So we pray for our city. Give us utterance for the next few moments, Lord, to cover areas of our city that we would never know in the natural, but you know by the Holy Ghost. Sambre vesuku shambre mondo savai ne romonda vramana vende vendele ala masambara tisa mosondi avo shongo romondo ramande vende vende vanda vande belendi ala lavosu mende broto sambre mendisa brondosso retisha la leise Nengoro mondo io mosson de batanze vetia la lama sambre botoshae veria masambro mondo bocumbre benivisa banana bassa balala vasibie Nende brocuto brocundo brefendi ada la masse fremondo su ne je provra pande vesifi alla lavassai nenge dereti a rondo sotto shata refikissa bala matasa mende brocusa prefidi atassa telli alla lavondi io busu na ja rava sifi e di divisi chi di atapparara nenge romotu sataya oh thank you Lord thank you Holy Ghost thank you Holy Ghost Lord, I ask you that by the Holy Ghost you begin to stir into every church in this city, and even those that are just in the region, but every church, that any church sitting back and be that might be complacent, light the place up, Lord. Light the place up. Light the place up. Our own house. May we be lit on the Holy Ghost. Light us up, Lord. Light us up, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. If the first time that a salvation message could have ever been preached, 3,000 people get saved, imagine how many people could get saved in a city after it's been done over and over and over again. People have heard and people, it's just not the first time. I'm reluctant to jump into anything the first time I hear about it. But after I see the goodness of it over and over and over again, it's like, okay, what am I waiting for? Let's go. Let's go. So hallelujah. Keep yourself stirred up for our city. We will see revival hit Lakeland. And not only will we see it hit, this is my heart for it, but we just won't see it come and go, but it'll come and remain. It'll come and remain. It won't be aborted before its time. I'm not saying that revival comes and it lasts for 75 years or what. I mean, it can. I don't know. God can do whatever he wants to do. But what it shouldn't be is aborted because somebody got in the way, because somebody messed something up. No, we'll keep all that out of the way, and the Holy Ghost can have free reign and move for as long as he needs to do and accomplish what he wants to accomplish. Hallelujah. Worship team, thank you very much. Glory be to God. You guys can be seated. Hallelujah. What a wonderful way to stir ourselves up at the beginning of this weekend. Again, I welcome all of you who might be guests. We're not treating this Friday night, Saturday morning, and Saturday night. I'll tell you those times specifically in a moment. We're not treating them as if we're trying to get you to come to our church. We're glad you're here today. But if you notice, when you came in, we didn't give you a visitor's card. We greeted you. We said hello or whatever. We don't have your address to send you a letter. We're not going to try to draw you away from wherever you are. But if you come Sunday morning, you're ours. Anyway. But we expect that lots of you probably have your own church homes, maybe here in Lakeland. We have some people from Brooksville, maybe some other people from various places, and we're glad you're here. We invite you to come as often as you can to these meetings this week. I know there's a small crowd tonight, but I have been in many meetings in 39 years of my existence, and sometimes the small ones are the best ones. You know, I mean, if God has a particular portion that he can pour out and there's fewer people to partake of it, that means you get a bigger slice of the pie. I know it doesn't exactly work that way. The truth of the matter is you can have all the eating you want. It's a buffet. So I challenge you, come hungry. Come hungry. Eat all you can and take home a doggy bag. So, yeah, take some home with you because it's not meant just for you. It's not meant just for you, but it's meant to be used by you and through you. So tonight, 7 o'clock, you're already here. Tomorrow morning, 10 a.m. Tomorrow night, 6 p.m. Sunday morning, 10 a.m. Sunday night, 6 p.m. Yep. All right, so tonight, 7. Tomorrow morning, what time?
10.
Tomorrow evening, what time?
6.
All right, now tomorrow evening is a little different because for those of you who are local or maybe you don't know at all, but we have a guest, I guess we'll call it a guest worship leader coming for Sunday morning, Ryan Horton, Saturday night, forgive me, Saturday night at what time?
6
o'clock. Okay, so Ryan Horton will be here. He's a local guy, has an incredible heart to see the glories of God poured out on our city. And I've known him since he was 4. I think I was about 8. We've known each other for that long. But I had lost touch with him for 30-some-odd years. And so I never knew really what was going on. I heard of different things from time to time. He became a national recording artist and toured with Israel Houghton and a few other things like that. But then God sent him back to Lakeland. And he said, I don't know why God sent me back to Lakeland. Well, actually, he does know why, because we're contending for something here. And so we got hooked up about two or three months ago, and so I asked him to come and be a part of this weekend. So Saturday night, 6 o'clock, we're just going to blow the roof off the joint. We'll have a full house. I don't know if I could guarantee it, but I sure would like to see it. Anyway, so just be here all you can. You'll see in the back, Brother Tom Scarrella has his table with his books and CDs and other people's books and stuff. That's one of the things I love about you. It's not just all about your stuff. You bring some stuff that doesn't have your name on it because the information that's contained inside of it is life-changing. So make sure you visit that table. And if you don't have monies to buy things today, you've got time because we have tomorrow morning and tomorrow night and Sunday. But by Sunday night, let's sell out. Let's get it all gone so he has an empty suitcase to bring home with him. There will be an offering later on tonight that will go to Brother Tom's ministry, and he'll be receiving that later on. But without further ado, let me introduce to you Brother Tom Scarrella. So come and have your liberty,
you, Pastor. Thank you very much.
All right. Well, praise the Lord. Good evening, everybody. Good to be back with you again. Children can be dismissed, all right? So they just go to children's church? Follow the leader. There you go. And let's do this. As the kids are going, everyone jump back to your feet. Why don't you introduce yourself to 2-3 people? We have some visitors here tonight from all over. Shake hands. Hi, how you doing? Good to see you.
Well, John's got it.
He's doing great.
Whatever he does, I don't want to.
Oh, really? Yeah, he's really got a real good vision for it.
He's excited for it.
I'm really excited for him now. Do you have a couple of ushers in your hands that I can get him to this? Okay, cool. I'm going to get you to hand these out. Thank you. Just if you can hand those out to everyone. All right, if you want to grab your seats. Yeah, you can do it now. You can grab your seats. We just want to give you one of these. Some of you have already got one, but you can take another one if you like. They're just a prayer card, and we pray over these, and we just love to stay connected with you. We have Facebook, if you're on Facebook or Instagram, and we also have a YouTube channel. Some of you guys found us through our YouTube channel that are here tonight, and it's funny, of everything that we've got with social media, YouTube is the number one draw that we have anywhere. It's the funniest thing, and Isn't that great? I mean, really, I mean, honest to God, anywhere in the world, it doesn't matter. And it's always number one is YouTube. So praise God. Glad you guys could come. At the end of the service, I do have, like Pastor John said, we do have some different books and CDs and stuff in the back. I'll just show you very, very quickly what we've got. How many of you like to worship? Anyone like to worship the Lord? We've got a brand new worship album. A guy who used to do worship for Reinhard Bonnke's ministry did this album, and it's called Heaven. And he did this for our ministry, and there's no words to it. It's just all instrumental, and it's just great meditative music. If you want to call it soaking music, whatever you want to call it, but it's brand new. You can get that. Last time we were here, I don't remember if we had this or not, but we had the Hearing God's Voice. This weekend, I'm going to talk a little bit about that. And so you can get our book. We put it in a manual format so that people could do it like a Bible study for themselves or reteach it if they'd like. Also, we've got some out-of-print books, like Pastor John said, and we've got some out-of-print books from 1946. How about that? Whatever that is, 70 years old. And what it's on is it's on fasting and prayer. And two unknown evangelists picked up these books that are in the back of the book table. The one fellow's name was Oral Roberts, and the other fellow's name was William Branham. In 1946, and they picked these up, and they went on a fast, a 21-day fast, and the healing revival was born in 1947. Isn't that something? So you can get these. These are real powerful. You won't be able to get these again, but these are real, real powerful books. We also just had a documentary that was done on our ministry, actually here, funny enough, in Lakeland, in your church. The last time we were here, do you remember that? They flew in from South Africa, and they did the whole thing was done right here in Lakeland. This whole video was done in, well, not the whole video, but a large chunk of it was done in South Africa, Switzerland, and Lakeland, Florida is the only place in America. Come on, somebody. Isn't that something? It just dawned on me. I remembered it because the one part of it we shot over here right on the lake over by the Starbucks, whichever way Starbucks, that way. Over by the Starbucks, that's where this was shot. And so this is literally going all over the world, but it's about God's voice. How many of you want to hear God's voice clearer? Anyone? And so this will really bless you. You can get that if you're interested. We've also got USB drives. If you're not familiar with that, everything is leaving CD and going that direction. So all new cars, that's all they have is USB. Also, we've got a brand new T-shirt. This is my wife's favorite one. It just says, I love God's presence. How many of you love God's presence? Anybody? All right. Well, at the end of the service, if you're interested, you can get those things. Thanks, Pastor John. Appreciate it. We want to say thank you to Pastor John. Thank you guys so much for having us. Come on, give your pastors a great big hand, will you? All of them. And you know what? I'll do that. I'll show that video on the presence of God. Let's do that. I wasn't going to do that, but just for a few minutes here tonight, we put together some pictures and ministry clips from literally all over the world. We actually just last week were in South Africa for a month. So if my eyes kind of get heavy, it's not the anointing, okay? It's called jet lag, all right? So, but this video clip literally is about 20 different countries on it. And so I think you'll be blessed. Watch this. I think there's some of Lakeland in this video too. Watch this. Just turn it up, brother, will you?
I need you more. More than yesterday, I need you more. More than words could say, I need you more than ever before. I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord, more than the air, more than the air. I never want to go back to my own life. I need you more.
Lord, yes,
I need you more than words can say. Lift your voice to the Lord. Lift your voice to the Lord. Lift your voice. Come on, church, lift your voice. Lift your voice. Lift your voice.
Come on, give Jesus a big hand clap here tonight. Woo! Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I get blessed every time I see that. Well, tonight, if you have your Bibles, I'm going to just read a scripture to you. We'll just receive an offering and then shift gears into what I feel the Lord's doing tonight. But I just want to read a scripture to you out of Genesis 26. So if you have your Bibles, look in Genesis 26. Are y'all okay tonight? Everyone good? Okay, cool. 2 years ago, we left Florida and we moved back to where we grew up in Minnesota. And so this is our first time back in Florida. Actually, I just flew in this morning, and so this is the first time in the last 2 years that we've been back in Florida. So it feels good. It feels like, man, hey, like I never left, you know. So, but Genesis 26 says, there was a famine. Everyone say there was a famine. He says, listen, there was a famine in the land besides the first famine that was in the days of Abraham. And Isaac went to Abimelech, king of the Philistines in Gerar, and the Lord appeared to him and said, do not go down to Egypt, but live in the land that I tell you. Dwell in this land, and I'll be with you, and I'll bless you. For you and your descendants, I'll give you all these lands, and I'll perform the oath that I swore to Abraham, your father. Now, here he says, listen, there was a famine in the land. Everyone say there was a famine. How many of you ever been in a famine financially? Anybody? Okay. So many of us have gone through times where we just, you know, been attacked or whatever it is, whatever wording you want to use, but just there was a famine. And so here's Isaac. Now here he is, the son of the father of faith. So Abraham's the father of faith. So here's his son, Isaac. And now God has to immediately, when he addresses Isaac about the famine, he says, listen, don't do like what your dad did. Because in the time of famine, Abraham did something. What did he do? He ran to Egypt. What did he find in Egypt? Hagar. What did he get from Hagar? Ishmael. So in the time of famine, when you read the earlier time that he's referring to here is in Genesis 12. So in Genesis 12, when the first famine hit, Abraham got fearful and he fled and he took off down to Egypt. When he went to Egypt, and that's when he went and met Hagar. That's when he went and had this good idea that wasn't a God idea, but it was a good idea. And he went and had a child, Ishmael, right? And then the Bible says about Ishmael and Isaac, the two shall always fight. Come on, right? They'll always fight. Doesn't matter who's president. Doesn't matter who's in the UN. Come on. Doesn't matter how much land you give them. Come on, somebody. Right? It's never enough. Why? Because God said that these two, there always be enmity between the two. Right? So here, God gives a clear prophetic word to Isaac. And so as Isaac comes on the scene, he says, do not fear. Right? Do not run in the time of fear. But as you keep on going down here in verse 12, it says, and Isaac sowed in that land. What land? The land where the famine was. Isaac stayed and sowed in that land. And he reaped the same year, how much? 100-fold. And the Lord blessed him, and he began to prosper, continued prospering until he became very prosperous. Right? So, that's why there's something about in the time of famine that we stand our ground, that we stand in our faith. Come on, right? That we don't get fearful, right? Sometimes people, when, you know, a financial crisis hits, instantly what they do is they stop giving. I mean, you literally just cut off the flow of the blessings of God back to you again. And my wife and I have proved this again and again ourselves. And, traveling all over different parts of the world and stuff like that. And with absolutely no guarantee. And I mean, I could tell you of time after time. I was looking at that video and when we went to Puerto Rico the first time in 2004, we were going to do a big crusade on a place called El Moro. And so as we were going to do this big crusade there, I had no money. And I needed $40,000. And I was 6 weeks away from the crusade. And I said, oh, God, what are we going to do? And here we are. We were in a major famine, and I didn't know what to do. And so my wife and I got together, and we said, all right, let's do this. Let's sow something that we feel. I said, all right, let's give your car away. So I volunteered to sew her car, all right? So we sewed her car into this missionary family to Mexico. And then on top of it, I said, let's do this. Let's sew them a financial seed and also a brand new laptop. So, man, I'm telling you, we felt it. You're in a financial lead, and you gave one of your only two cars, come on. And then on top of it, you gave a laptop that you needed actually yourself. And then on top of that, you also needed those finances, right? So, I mean, you could hear the enemy's talking in your ear. Like, what in the world are you doing? You're going deeper in the hole instead of coming out of the hole, right? But everyone say, sow in that land. And so that's what we did. So we sowed in that land. And the following week after we did that, we didn't tell anybody, but we went to minister in California. So we just kind of shared it out there. Listen, we're going to do a crusade in Puerto Rico. And we don't speak a lick of Spanish on top of it. But we're trusting God for a harvest of souls. And it's going to cost our ministry about $40,000. So at the end of the service, this couple came to me and said, listen, we want to sow into Puerto Rico, but we have no money. I'm like, great, where is this going? You know what I mean? I mean, the clock is ticking. Now we're down to 5 weeks away, right? And so they said, we've got a property in California that nobody wants. We've had it on the market for 6 years. Nobody's bid on it. But if you'll pray that God sells the property in the next 3 to 4 weeks above the asking price, $70,000 above. I mean, they really made it tough on God. Come on, right? So they didn't want just the asking price, but $70,000 above the asking price. Then we'll give you $40,000 for Puerto Rico. Man, I'll tell you what, we went into emergency tongues. I'll tell you right there. Man, I'll tell you, we prayed like a house of fire right there, man. I'm telling you what, right? So we're praying our guts out right there in the foyer of the church. And sure enough, I find out that week, someone drove by the property, offered them $75,000 above the asking price. Come on, somebody. And God came through. Come on, give the Lord a hand clap. Amen. So in the time of famine, everyone say that loud. Say, in the time of famine, sow your seed. Right? That's why it says the same thing over in the book of Ecclesiastes. In Ecclesiastes 10, it says it like this. It says, don't curse the rich even in your bedroom, because a bird of the air may carry your words. Then it says in chapter 11, verse 1, it says, but cast your bread on the water, for you'll find it after many days. Amen. So it's the same thing. Amen. So tonight we want to give you an opportunity to just sow a seed. So tonight, if you need an offering envelope, is there offering envelopes on the seats in front of them? So you can grab one of the offering envelopes and you can make out a check to Believers Fellowship. Thank you, sir. Hallelujah. I'm in so many churches, it's like left me like a bird. So Believers Fellowship, if you want to make out a check. And so, and you spell million, M-I-L-L-I-O-N, all right? So praise God. So we'll just give you a second to fill out your offering envelope. Hallelujah. Praise God. Well, if you're ready to give, say amen. All right, so Father, tonight in the name of Jesus, bless the gift and the giver. Multiply it back to him again, manyfold over. Lord, there are people here tonight that need a breakthrough in their finances. Lord, they are in the time and the season of famine. Lord, even as you gave this word tonight, Lord, I pray that they'll be blessed abundantly even before the end of this month. We ask for a harvest of finances coming in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Go for it, guys. All right. Well, tonight, just for a few minutes here, and we'll just kind of see how the Lord leads this weekend. But if you got your Bibles, I want to talk to you a little bit this weekend about prophetic ministry and hearing God's voice and stuff like that. So if you got your Bibles, go with me to John chapter 10. I'm going to give you a lot of scriptures, so forgive me for that. Is that all right? All right. So I'm a word guy, so I like a lot of it. All right. So John 10, so John chapter 10 says this, most assuredly I say to you, he that does not enter into the sheepfold by the door, but climbs in another way, the same as a thief and a robber. But he who enters by the door of the shepherd, but he who enters by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. to him, the doorkeeper opens, and the sheep hear his voice. Underline that. The sheep what? Hear his voice, right? And he calls his own sheep by name, and he leads them out. When he brings out his own sheep, he goes before them, and his sheep follow him, for they know his voice. That's the second time he says it. And yet they will by no means follow a stranger, but will flee from him, for they do not know the voice of strangers. This is why it blows my mind when people are talking about the devil said this and the devil said that. How do you know the voice of a stranger so well when Jesus said you won't know the voice of a stranger? Come on, right? Jesus used this illustration, but they did not understand the things by which he spoke, right? Then he keeps on talking about in the same thought. He keeps on going. Jesus said to them, most assuredly, I say to you, I'm the door to the sheep. All that ever came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. I am the door, and everyone, and if anyone enters by me, he'll be saved, and I will go in and out and find pasture. The thief does not come except to steal, kill, and destroy. I've come that they may have life, that they may have it more abundantly, right? So here he's sheep, shepherd, door, sheep, shepherd. Then as you keep on going over to verse 22, now it was the Feast of Dedication in Jerusalem, and it was winter, and Jesus walked in the temple in Solomon's porch, and the Jews surrounded him and said to him, how long do you keep us in doubt? If you are the Christ, tell us plainly. And Jesus answered them, I told you, and you do not believe. The works that I do in my Father's name, they bear witness of me. But you do not believe because you are not of my sheep, as I said to you. My sheep, here he says it again, third time, hear my voice, right? And I know them, and they follow me, and I give them eternal life, that they shall never perish, neither shall any snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. So here he begins to speak about the voice, and he begins to speak about the shepherd and the sheep. So three times in chapter 10, he says, my sheep hear, my sheep hear. You know, really to reach the city, is we have to begin to, more than ever before, we have to hear the voice of the shepherd, right? And I believe in the day and the hour that we live, more than ever before, we really need to sharpen the hearing God's voice in our lives. Come on, is that all right to say? I mean, I didn't even tell anything to Pastor John tonight. And all I told him was I was ministering on hearing God's voice. That's all I said. But I had already set and determined in the back of the church, okay, the moment he gives me the microphone, we're going to spend several minutes praying in the Spirit. So what did he pick up? He picked that up by the same Holy Ghost. Come on, somebody. And that's what he picked up. And so what did he do? He did it not only once, he went into, right back into it again, right? Why? Because he was hearing the voice of the shepherd. Come on, amen. And I believe that the Lord will begin to give us the keys of people's hearts. Now, I just flew in just a few hours ago from Minneapolis, all right? So my day started this morning at 3:30 a.m. And so I went to the airport and then flew from there to Atlanta and from Atlanta here. And so our flight was a little delayed flying from Atlanta here to Orlando. And so as my flight was a little bit delayed, I went and we sat on the tarmac there for a while. And I just sat down and I just flippantly said to the Lord, I said, Lord, give me an opportunity to share with this lady that's sitting next to me on the plane. But I said, God, give me a word. I need a prophetic word for this woman. I said, I need a sharp word of knowledge for this woman to reach this woman. So instantly the Lord gives me a name. So she's engrossed in this conversation, and so these two ladies are in business, and they're visiting with each other, and neither one of them are from Florida at all. They're actually coming here on business, and so they're just visiting away and stuff. And so finally, right when we were just about to land, finally she stopped. I mean, they were just chatty Cathy the whole time, and right when they kind of stopped, she had gotten out some gum, and so she said to her friend, would you like some gum? And so she took one, and she looked at me, and she goes, would you like one? I said, sure, and I just used that as an opportunity. So I went and I said to her, I said, this is going to sound crazy. I said, but I sense in my heart that you're a woman of God and you're a woman of prayer. And she got like tears in her eyes. She said, I am. I'm a Christian. And I said, I'm practicing hearing God's voice. Everyone say that out loud. I'm practicing hearing God's voice. So that's all I said. I said, listen, I'm practicing hearing God's voice. And this is what I sense, that there's somebody in your life by the name of Angie, but you call her Sanji or something. And when I said that, her eyes got big and she just started weeping. And I said, what happened? Who is she? She said, well, she's an old friend who reached out to me in a time when my marriage failed. And she said, I went through a terrible divorce. And she said, in my brokenness of my divorce, she said, this lady, I call her Sanji. She said, so it's kind of a funny name, right? And she said, I just call her Sanji. And she said, she reached out to me. And she said, I, at that time, was not living for God. And so she said, I made some real poor choices, and I hurt our friendship. And I just immediately began to speak into that. And I said, God gave me that name for this purpose, is he's going to restore that relationship with your friend, Sanji. I said, not only is he going to restore it, but I said, also the finances that you've been desperately needing, I said, the Lord is saying he's going to release those to you even now. And she was just, I mean, bawling like a baby. She did not want to get up. I mean, when everybody's walking out of the plane, I'm like, hey, I want to get out of the plane too, you know? But God was just so touching this lady's life. Come on, somebody, give Jesus a hand. Amen. Through that one simple word, it was like God just unlocked that woman's heart. Amen. I mean, I can tell you of time after time where God has just given me, you know, strange things like that, where I've just seen where God has given me a word of knowledge for somebody, and they've been dramatically healed. I remember we did a healing conference in Fort Lauderdale about 5 years ago. And so we brought this friend of ours in from Kansas, and he did this conference with us. And so we went out evangelizing one day. And so we went to a flea market. Okay, he's from Kansas. They don't have Florida flea markets, you know. I don't know what you guys call it up here, but we called it in Fort Lauderdale, we called it Swap Shop. Is that the same thing up here? Oh, it's like a flea market. Okay. So we went down there, and he's like, man, this is like the fields are white here, man. He couldn't believe it. I mean, how many, you know, people were there? And so we were praying and ministering to people, and we ended up having an opportunity to minister to these two Jewish guys. And so when we started talking to these two Jewish guys, he instantly goes right into a word of knowledge, and he begins to say to this Jewish guy, he said, hey, listen, we're looking for someone that has physical pain today. Do you have any physical pain? The guy said, no. And my friend said, by word of knowledge, he said, yeah, but what about that car accident you and your friend had 2 years ago and the pain between your shoulders? And these two Jewish guys were like, how do you know about that? And instantly their hearts were so laid bare. Come on, somebody. We were able to share the gospel. We prayed for them. They were healed dramatically. They were weeping. I mean, they were just caught in the valley of decision. Come on. Everyone's just say words of knowledge. Amen. And so that's one of the ways that I believe that we're going to really begin to minister in the city. So, you know, especially in the area of prophecy. So now go over to your right. Go over to the book of 1 Corinthians. So 1 Corinthians 14. So 1 Corinthians 14. So let me say it like this. How many of you ever heard that saying, a picture's worth? Okay, so let me say it to you like this. An accurate prophetic word is stronger than 1,000 sermons. Even as a picture is worth 1,000 words, one prophetic word can say what 1,000 sermons were saying at the same time. But there's something about it. It's almost like it encapsulates everything in there. Come on, right? It's like there's something in that, it just encapsulates it. I mean, I could tell you I have hundreds of testimonies of words of knowledge of ministering to people, and we've seen people saved and stuff. We had an agnostic lady come to one of our meetings once here last year, and so I called out words of knowledge, and I said, there's a woman here. I said, you have this terrible, excruciating pain in your lower back. I said, actually, it's your kidneys. You've known it for a long time. And so I just went on and on and on with this word of knowledge. Nobody moves. Nobody raises their hand. I said, it's a woman. And I said, you're sitting right in the center aisle here. Now, really, nobody's moving. I said, I sense you're in the near the back. And I point near the back of the church. And this girl gets up and she's crying. She starts crying and she starts waving her face like this. And she's like, I've never been in anything like this in my life. How do you know that? By the end of the service, she got born again. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. Come on, give the Lord a hand clap. Amen. So 1 Corinthians 14 says, pursue love, desire spiritual gifts. Desire spiritual gifts. Desire spiritual gifts. The word desire there is the strongest word in the Greek language. It actually means lust after spiritual gifts. That's the literal translation, lust after spiritual gifts. It's not like, well, God, if you want me to have it, I'll just get it. No, no, no. It's an intense craving for it. Here he says, pursue love, desire, or lust, or crave after spiritual gifts, but especially that you may prophesy. So here he lifts prophecy up above the other nine gifts of the Spirit. Right? Or the other eight gifts of the Spirit. So of the nine gifts, somehow he lifts up prophecy above them. Then in verse 2, for he that speaks in an unknown tongue does not speak unto men, but unto God. For no one understands him, howbeit in the Spirit he speaks mysteries. But he that prophesies speaks exhortation, edification, and comfort to men. Edification, exhortation, comfort. So simple prophecy has no revelation in it at all. Come on, right? So simple prophecy is just edification, exhortation, comfort, right? How many of you ever had someone say something real nice to you and it just made you just feel good? Come on, raise your hand. Anybody? There's an element of prophecy in what they were saying or the manner by which that they were saying, especially if it's a believer, right? And so there's a small element of prophecy in that. Now, I'll just give you my testimony, okay? So my testimony is a little different in this, in that I got saved as a young teenager. And so as I got saved as a young teenager, I was 16. I didn't have a wonderful spirit-filled church like you guys have. I grew up in Western Minnesota in a town of 732 people. We had one stop sign. You understand? All right. We had two gas stations. We thought we had arrived. But God sent a man from 100 miles away to come to my little podunk town, and he got about 15 kids saved. Now, most of us are in the ministry. In fact, one of us is the youth pastor at Rhema in Tulsa. He's the youth pastor down there, and so, or junior high pastor. And so, So I believe he heard from God. I mean, of all places, he would pick our little town. But so here I get radically saved, and my family were not excited that I got saved. And because I, you know, did the unpardonable thing, you know, and here I went and got radically born again in their eyes. And but here I was hungry for God, and so they had this Bible study every week. And so here, this is when I first got introduced to Kenneth Hagin's ministry and stuff. And so I went and I was given that book on prophecy. And so I began to read that. And so I eventually graduated high school in 1984. And I went to a secular university my first year of school. And so as I did, they had the Assemblies of God Church there in that town. They had this they call it Chi Alpha. It's like a college group, but it's quite large. So there was about 100 or so of us kids. And so we would meet every morning at 7 a.m. to pray from 7 till 8. And we were in a room smaller than the size of your stage. And I mean, we were packed like sardines in there, you know. And so we would pray in the Spirit, and man, it was wild. Well, after about the first week, of going to this prayer meeting, I remember I was crying out to the Lord. I said, God, I want to be used in prophecy. God, I want you to use me in words of knowledge. And so the next morning, I got up and went to go pray with these guys. So we went to go pray. And so as we're praying that next morning, it was just like a normal Wednesday morning or whatever. And so here I am praying. I'm praying in tongues. And all of a sudden, a scripture comes in my head and my heart starts beating fast. And I knew I had to share it. I'm like, oh, God, rapture me out of here now, Lord, please, Jesus. And my heart starts beating faster and faster and faster. And then all of a sudden, everyone got quiet. And it just was dead silent forever. I'm like, oh, Lord, no. And so I just said, I don't know how to do this, but this is what I feel like God's saying. And when I said that, it felt like an atomic bomb went off. And I just quoted this scripture. Come on. And everyone started weeping. Amen. So that's how it began with me, was all of those 30-some years ago, right? So 30-some years ago, that's how it began with me. And then after that, I began to say, Lord, I want you to start to use me with words of knowledge for sick people. And so I began to start to cry out to the Lord in 20-some years ago. And so since then, we do it all the time, especially with words of knowledge for the sick. Because it's a great way by which you can activate people for healing who don't even know for sure if they still struggle with it. You know, I remember when we were here with Curry back, what was that, about three years ago, yeah. So about 3 years ago when we were here with Curry Blake, I remember the one service, someone brought somebody that was sick and they were not a Christian. And that was a session that I preached. And so I just got up in that session and I began to start to call out people for healing, for words of knowledge. And so as I did, the very first one, no one moved. And I said, come on, I know you're here, it's not me. And so it was just kind of awkward quiet in here because I was doing this by faith. Come on, how many of you got saved by faith? Okay, so the same faith you got saved with is the same faith that you're used to be used in the gifts of the Holy Spirit with. Come on, right? So it's the same faith, right? So right here in this same building, I just waited. I said, come on, it's a lady. And I just started going down. I said, it's a lady. I want to say, I almost said middle-aged lady. Oh, God, Jesus. That would have been terrible. I don't know if that would have been unforgivable if I would have said that, you know. But anyways, finally, this woman jumps up and she comes down. Well, here, someone had brought her to the service and bam, she got healed right here in the altar in that service, rededicated her life to Jesus. Come on, somebody. Amen. Hallelujah. Right? And so how was it? It was by hearing the words of the Lord. Amen. So right here in 1 Corinthians 14, so here in 1 Corinthians 14, he says it like this. Listen, he that prophesies, he just speaks edification, exhortation, comfort, right? So in other words, you can literally just give someone a scripture and or whatever, just some kind of a word of encouragement, and it have that element of, come on, of just basic prophecy. But there's also on top of that where we can begin to start to mix what we call words of knowledge, right? Or even words of wisdom. Now, words of wisdom, if you don't know this, are for future things. Words of knowledge are present or past. So I'll say that again. Words of wisdom are for future things. God is going to do. God is going to do this in the future, right? Words of knowledge are, it's happening now or it happened in the past. Amen. And so now just talking about words of knowledge here, just for a few minutes, that it can get zeroed in as much as you are able to by faith, right? So just like you got saved by faith, then you got filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke in tongues by faith. How many of you remember that day you spoke in tongues by faith? Anyone? Keep your hands up real high. Let me see. Okay. So how many of you remember that before that day? Oh, God, that was just like a mountain that could not be crossed. Remember that? I mean, it was just like impossible. How can I do this? I can't understand it. And then the moment you did it, you're like, oh my gosh, that's the easiest thing I ever did. Come on, somebody. How many of you thought that, right? Afterwards, you're like, man, that was the easiest thing I've ever done, right? So it's the same exact same thing as the rest of the gifts of the Spirit, right? So it's by faith. That's why Paul keeps on saying, he that prophesies, let him prophesy according to his measure of faith, right? So it's all done by faith. So you can activate it by faith. Come on, right? So you can activate it by faith. The same thing is true regarding praying in the Spirit. You don't have to wait for a special anointing. Right? You can do it by faith, right? So the same thing is true with hearing from God. I mean, you could do the same thing. I say it like this. God is always broadcasting. Proverbs says, wisdom is crying in the streets. Who will hear her voice? So in other words, heaven's always broadcasting. And those words are in the atmosphere right now. Come on, right? So we, by faith, we begin to step over and we begin to demonstrate the kingdom of God. Now, let me say it to you like this. Okay. Now, you kind of have to know my background and stuff. But I'll tell you the one thing that frustrates me is now in this day and age of all of this reality TV, we've got people, we've got psychic detectives, and we've got psychic this stuff. How many of you notice that stuff all over the television all the time, right? Now, how many of you remember in the Old Testament when Moses went and took his rod and threw it down, right? But then so did the sorcerers at Egypt. They threw theirs down, and what happened? Moses' rod ate theirs up, right? So in other words, to say they both were doing the same miracle, but by different gods. Come on, right? They both were doing the same thing, but by different gods. Come on, right? So I think it's a travesty that the church is not beginning to minister and beginning to step out in words of knowledge like this. And we're leaving it to the devil and his cohorts. Come on, right? Time for the church to go for it. Come on, everyone say, I'm going for it. So Pastor John and I were talking about, man, this is part of what I believe that God wants to create a hunger in the church for. Now we have a wonderful prophet friend. If he comes this way, I'll have to send him your way. He's one of the most amazing prophets I ever met. Now, I've only personally ever met about 8 to 9 prophets in my whole life. There's a lot of them call themselves prophets, but they're really non-profit. But this guy's a real deal. He went to India. He was ministering in India, he was in the pastor's car, and they were on their way to go to the crusade. He said, "Pastor, give me your phone quick. And so he grabbed the pastor's cell phone. And so he grabbed the pastor's cell phone, and he began to dial this number that he saw in the spirit right above him as they were driving. They weren't in the meeting. They weren't in worship. Come on, somebody. They're driving in the car. And he called that number, and he picked up the phone, and it answered. And here it was, a multi-billionaire there in India. And the guy answered, and he was a Hindu. And so my friend Prophet William starts to prophesy to him, begins to tell him, you own your own gold mines, but you've been losing everything because you can't find gold anymore. This guy started weeping on the phone. This guy gets saved on the phone. And the guy said, "I'm getting my wife and all my kids, and we're flying in our private jet. We're coming to the meeting right now." And he made his whole family come, and the whole family got saved that night. Come on, somebody. In his private jet. So he's telling me this story. So William's telling me this story. We brought him here to America. We bring him here every year. We do a prophetic conference together. And so he's telling me this story, right? So now we had just stopped to get something to eat, all right? He's from South Africa. And so he loves Kentucky Fried Chicken. He just thinks it's just, I'm like, "God, please don't tell anybody. I got you Kentucky Fried Chicken. I'll be so embarrassed." But he's like, "Man, I love your Kentucky Fried Chicken." So I take him there, and so we go to get this, and so we're enjoying this Kentucky Fried Chicken. I'm like, "William, don't touch anything, all right? You got chicken all over you, all right?" So we're driving. We're on our way to Wisconsin to go minister. So as we are, we're in our truck, and so William's telling me this story of India. So William says, "Quick, give me a pen," and they don't call it a napkin. They call it a serviette, right? Okay, so that's the British word for napkin. Napkin, in the British terms, is a diaper. So he said, give me a serviette and give me a pen. And so I quickly give him the napkin and the paper, and he starts to write this number down that he sees as I'm driving to the conference, right? And I said, what is it? He goes, I don't know. What is this number? And I look at it. It's about 20 numbers long. I was like, I don't know what that is. He goes, oh, God will show me later. So he puts this chicken-filled Kentucky Fried Chicken wrapper in his pocket. And he goes, God will show me later. And so we get to the service, and we start ministering to people, and he calls out this woman, and this woman, he said, you have two children, you have a boy and a girl, but all the gifts are in the girl. The woman says, no, I only have a girl. He said, no, you have a boy and a girl, and all the gifts are in the girl. She said, no, my daughter's, I know, my daughter's almost 40. I've only got a boy, I only have a girl. He said, no, you have a boy and a girl, but all the gifts are in the girl. And she went, oh. She said, I had a miscarriage 40 years ago, and it was a boy. He said, yes, God says all the gifts are now in the girl. So now everybody's like, whew. I mean, everybody's crying when he gives that word, you know. So we're all crying. And so William looks at me as everyone's crying. He goes, should I get the serviette out? I'm like, brother, it's your meeting. I don't know. Do what you want, you know. So he pulls out this right in front of everybody, Kentucky Fried Chicken. I'm like, great. So he pulls this out, and he looks at this number, and he says, Max, where's Max? And so this guy walking in the back of the church says, I'm Max. And so he says, come on in here, Max. And so he looks at the first five numbers, and he says, 11297. And the guy says, that's my home address. Then he looks at the next five numbers, and he says, 5421. And the guy says, that's my office address. And then William looks at these last 10 numbers, and it says, he goes, 715, whatever, 555, 2121. And the guy goes, that's my unlisted phone number I got yesterday morning. Come on, somebody. Amen. Hallelujah. So I believe that God can allow us to get as sharp as we want to in the Spirit. Come on, right? Not just a once an occasion, but a constant flow. So here's what I wrote down. I wrote down about a half a dozen things. If you want to write these down, you can. So number one, I wrote this down. Number one, the simple gift of prophecy is edification, exhortation, and comfort. Number two, prophecy stirs a person's heart that God knows them. A prophetic word stirs someone's heart that God knows them. Come on, right? So you give someone a prophetic word about their spouse, they feel, you know what they hear? I made the right choice in a spouse. Come on, right? So there's something about the prophetic word. This is what it does, right? So number three, I went and I wrote this down. I already said this to you. Encouragement. When you speak a word of encouragement to somebody, it has an element of prophecy in it. Just a simple encouragement has an element of prophecy in it. Now, we were ministering up north in a conference in the dead of winter a couple of years ago. And as we were, it was a prophetic conference. And so I began to challenge the people. I said, listen, we're going to do something tonight you've never done before ever in church. I said, everyone get your cell phones out. So everyone got their cell phones out. So they're like, all right. I said, all right, get on your Facebook, Instagram, whatever you got, Snapchat, whatever. And I said, and just pick two people and just pray over them and then write them something dear from your heart that you feel God wants them to know. We still get testimonies back from doing that there that night. Just simply just practicing. Come on, somebody. Everyone say practice. I mean, man, you go to the doctor, they're practicing medicine. And you still got to pay. You still got to pay while they're practicing. Come on, right? So we can practice hearing God's voice. Come on, right? And so then I went and I said to the people, I said, all right, here's what you're going to do. Now everyone's all excited because now they've been given prophetic words on Facebook. And now I said, okay, now you're going to do this. You're going to pray in the spirit and God's going to show you a strange place to go tonight. And for 5 minutes, you're going to walk in there and you're just going to speak a word of encouragement to someone and it's going to be a divine appointment. So one woman and her friend, the two of them have been saved since, I mean, they came out of the womb, they were saved. I mean, they've been in church their whole life. Come on, right? I mean, they've never been in the world, these two women. And sitting there, they were praying in the spirit, and they both had the same vision. They saw a bar near where they live. And they saw them walk into the bar, and there were two attorneys sitting at the bar. And they walked in the vision. They saw themselves walk up to the bar and share with the one guy, your wife is right. You need to start to listen to your wife. That's what they saw in the vision. I mean, and what a strange vision, right? So they get in the car. It's a blizzard out. I mean, it was 20 below zero. And they drive to that bar. And they get out of the car. There's like almost nobody in the bar. They walk into the bar. They're like, oh, God. They said, we were in emergency tongues praying, you know. And so they walk into the bar. And they walk up to the bar. And there's two guys. They're talking. And they're in very distinguished suits. And as they're both in distinguished suits, the one lady said, I just felt compelled to talk to the one fellow whose back was to me. So she walked up to him. She said, I touched him on the shoulder. And said, excuse me, we just came from church. And we've been praying, and God showed you to me in the church that you and your wife have been quarreling about God, but your wife is right. You need to listen to your wife. And the guy starts crying right there in the bar. He said, I just left the house because we were screaming and yelling about going to church. She's been trying to get me to go to church. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. So praise God for the prophetic word, right? Number five, words of knowledge are zeroed in much more specific. Words of knowledge are zeroed in and much more specific. Just like with that lady today, Sanji. What a strange name, right? So words of knowledge are much more zeroed in and to be specific to somebody, right? Okay. Number six, words of knowledge tend to shock people open to the prophetic word. Words of knowledge tend to shock people, right? Because it's like a sign and a wonder. So a word of knowledge shocks somebody into hearing what God has to say to them. So the word of knowledge is just to open the heart for that person to begin to listen. Come on, amen. So that's what the purpose of the word of knowledge is. So God wants to give us words of knowledge of all kinds of different stuff, right? God wants to give us the words of knowledge to see people saved or whatever it might be, right? Or maybe it's in your business dealings. You don't know what to do. Man, you just need a word from God. You need a word of knowledge. Come on, right? I mean, our friend Prophet William, he's flown in every month by Muslim businessmen in Dubai. And all he does is prophesy to them for 60 minutes, and then they fly him home in a private jet. Come on, somebody, amen. Because he's prophesying into their business dealings. Come on. I mean, I believe just exactly like that thing with Moses. Come on, right? If Moses could throw down his rod and his rod eat the rods of Pharaoh, come on, we should be able to do much greater. Everyone say greater things. Right? So we say we believe in greater things. But when somebody does greater things, man, I don't know about this, you know. Right? Okay, so I think it's number seven, right? Number seven was the end of the word of knowledge is the prophetic message. There's always a message that follows. So the word of knowledge opens the heart to receive the prophetic message. What is God saying? Just like I said to that lady today. Boom. I gave her the word of knowledge. Bam. It opened her heart. At that moment, then all of a sudden, I began to say to her, this is what God says. God's going to restore that relationship with that woman, right? And she just broke out weeping and crying. Now, how can we get there? So this weekend, I just felt in my heart, when Pastor John and I were talking about this weekend, I just felt in my heart what God has, you know, for your church right here, for this church, is I felt this weekend is that God wants to take us all to the next level this weekend. Is that all right? In hearing the voice of God like never before. Come on, right? And I just believe that God is going to really begin to sharpen our ears to begin to hear, thus saith the Lord. And God's going to just use us to minister to people in the strangest of places. I'll just tell you a funny story. Speaking of word of knowledge, how many remember Katrina, right? Remember the Katrina hurricane, right? So when Katrina took place there in Louisiana, there was a group of people from Bill Johnson's church went there, and they flew there to go minister to people. And there were two young prophetic guys that were all excited to go there, and they just knew that there was something greater than just bringing bottled water, that they were going to bring something else, and they would have divine encounters. So as they were praying, they had the church pray for them. And so as the church prayed for them, a lady in the back said, the Lord says, the first door will be closed, but don't worry, the second door will be open. Go through that door no matter what it says. And I thought, well, that's a weird word. So they get in the plane, they fly from Redding, California, and they fly to Louisiana. So they get to Louisiana, and as they get there to the Superdome, the first door they come to, they go to open it, and it's locked. And they're like, man, I don't know, how do we get in here? And so the one guy said, remember, the first door will be locked, but the second one will be open no matter what it says. So they come around the corner, and it says, high voltage, do not enter, danger. They had a word. So they went and they said, well, no matter what it says. So they went and they opened the door. So they opened the door and they walk in. And when they walked in, they were right on the set of Oprah Winfrey. So they were 20 feet from Oprah Winfrey. And they were just about to shoot a broadcast from the Superdome. And so they're like, oh my God, you know, here's Oprah Winfrey. And these two great big bouncers grab them and are like, get out of here. And they're about to throw them and hurl them out the door of the Superdome. And as they're dragging them out, the one guy said, I just threw up a prayer. God, give me a word for Oprah. And he had a picture in his mind of a little red bicycle that when she was 7 years old, it was stolen from her front of her house. So he just yelled out, Oprah, God told me to tell you that when you were 7 years old, that you used to have a little red bike that was stolen out of the front of your front yard. And she goes, stop. Nobody knows that. How do you know that? And then they let both men go, and both the men went over to her, and for 5 minutes they began to prophesy to Oprah Winfrey. Come on, somebody. And as they began to do so, she just began to weep under the presence of God. She said, nobody knows that story of when I was 7 years old in that little red bike. Come on. Everyone say razor sharp. I'm telling you, I want to be razor sharp. How many of you want to be razor sharp with the voice of the Lord? Amen. I'm telling you, I want to be razor sharp. I don't want to be vague. You know, a vague word, let me say it like this. A vague word of knowledge is like tongues. It needs to be interpreted. I see this pink elephant dancing on flowery clouds, and you're like, wow. Okay, well, now it's got to be interpreted. You understand? Yeah, exactly, right? So, but what do we see from that? What we see from that is, hey, listen, a vague word doesn't bring much help. You know what I mean? And so, but there's something about that sharp word. Now, here in 1 Corinthians 14, let me see if I could kind of backtrack a little bit. But here in 1 Corinthians 14, in verse 6. Verse 6. But now, brethren, if I come to you speaking with tongues, what shall I profit you unless I speak to you either by... Now, write these four things down. Or write them in the flyleaf of your Bible right there. He says, if I come to you speaking with tongues, do I come to you either by... Number one is what? Revelation. Number two, knowledge. Number three, prophesying. Number four, teaching. Now, leave that verse up there. Those are the four different uses of your tongues when you speak in tongues. Come on, right? Revelation, knowledge, prophesying, and teaching. All of the teachings of a man by the name of Kenneth Hagin, you can hear it in all of his teachings, he learned by praying in the Spirit and interpreting it. Everything he learned on flowing in the Spirit, everything he learned on the gifts of the Spirit, everything he learned on faith, all of it, his teaching, and all of it was done, and his knowledge was done by praying in the Spirit. Come on, right? So we see teaching and by knowledge, right? But then there's two other ones here. We also see revelation. And we also see, what else do we see? We see prophesying. So tongues and interpretation can also equal prophecy, right? So what that says to me is this. Now, if I said, all right, everybody pray in tongues. Now, Pastor John just did that at the beginning of the service, right? So at the beginning of the service, he said, all right, everyone pray in tongues. Now, you didn't just say, now, wait a second, I have to wait for the Spirit. You just did it by faith, right? So then how do you interpret your tongue? By faith. Come on, right? All of this kingdom stuff, all of the gifts of the Spirit are activated by your faith. So how do you begin to pray in tongues? Oh, I just do it. I just do it by faith. And you don't even think about it. Why? Because now your faith has grown so much in that, that the pastor can get up and just say, all right, let's keep praying in tongues, right? He could have said, because he's got a good voice, he could have said, let's sing in tongues. Does he? Yeah. So he could have said, let's sing in tongues. Come on, right? And you could have sang in tongues. But guess what? You could have also sang the interpretation. Or you could also speak the interpretation. Right? Now, it's not a translation. Now, I don't speak Spanish. You speak Spanish, right? No. You speak Spanish, right? Okay. So if I said something in English and then she interpreted it, right? The translation may be longer or shorter. Come on, right? And so often this is what gets people all freaked out is you may give a word in tongues and it be 30 seconds long, but the interpretation is 10 seconds. Yeah. Because you're just summarizing, come on, what God's been saying in that other language. Come on, amen. So you're just saying, well, this is basically what God's saying. You're just kind of, it's just a summary. Amen? And so, but you're picking things up like this all the time in the Spirit. I'm going to prove it to you tonight, okay? You're picking things up all the time by the Spirit, okay? And I know I'm jumping around a little bit here, but I promise you I'm going somewhere here, all right? So how many of you ever woke up in the morning and a song was playing in your head? Raise your hand. Ah, okay. So that was a word of knowledge. In the song is a phrase or a word that God is trying to communicate to you. Your spirit, see, your mind, your soul, and your body were tired, and so you were sleeping. So finally you shut up. Right? But your spirit, man, was still talking to God all night long. I mean, Morse code, back and forth, right? So the messages that were coming in, now when you began to wake up, your soul caught part of that, and you call it a vision or a dream, or you call it just hearing a song in your head. But in there, you are actually capturing what God Almighty spoke to you. Come on, right? So God is busy speaking constantly to you. And the moment you begin to start to see that, all of a sudden now you realize, hey, God is trying to communicate all the time. He's communicating to you when you sleep. He's communicating to you when you're awake. He's communicating to you in church. He's communicating to you all the time. Why? Because he's wanting you and I to sharpen our ears to hear. Amen. He's wanting us to sharpen our ears that we can hear, that we could clearly hear the voice of the master. And the moment we begin to do that, now all of a sudden we step into the realm of where we begin to start to hear the voice of the master, and it becomes laser focused instead of so generic and broad. Come on, amen? And so now I want to give you one last scripture. Go over to 1 Corinthians 14. Verse 31. Now, tomorrow, like Pastor John said, we have tomorrow morning, tomorrow night, Sunday morning, Sunday night. We'll kind of continue along this lines, and we're going to push you. Is that all right? Can we push you this weekend? Is that all right? Can we push you to grow? Is that okay? All right. So if you come to just sleep in church, you probably better not come to those services. All right. All right. So 1 Corinthians 14 and verse 31. In verse 31, it says it like this. For you can all prophesy one by one, that you may learn and all may be encouraged. So here he doesn't say only certain ones can prophesy. Who can prophesy? Oh, all of us can prophesy. Amen. So all of us can begin to prophesy. So now all of a sudden we say, hey, wait a second. All of us can prophesy, that we can all learn, right? Then in verse 32, he ends it with this. He says this, and the spirits of the prophets are subject to the prophets. Now, in the Greek, it says it like this. Okay, Lord, help me get this right. And the spirit is subject to the prophet. I'll say that again. The spirit is subject to the prophet. Not the prophet is subject to the spirit. Lord, tonight may this revelation fall. I'll say it one more time. The scripture says the spirit, now it's not plural there in the Greek, it's singular. And the spirit is subject. Now, there it's small. But you have to understand, in the Greek, it's not capitalized. So in the Greek language, when this was written, it should say it like this, capital S. And the spirit, who is the spirit? The Holy Spirit, is subject to the prophets. It does not say the prophets are subject to the spirit. Come on, somebody. Are you getting this? So it's the spirit is subject to you. You are not subject to the spirit. So what do you mean by that? Regarding prophecy, just like tongues. I mean, if I said, all right, everyone pray in tongues, and you start praying in tongues. Yeah, but what if the Holy Ghost doesn't want to pray in tongues? Well, let me just say it like this. You can't, of course, it's by your spirit. The spirit is subject to your spirit. Come on, is that true? The spirit, you don't say, wait a second, let me just check with God. Is it okay to speak in tongues? Come on. No, the spirit is subject to my spirit. Come on, somebody. Come on, get this here tonight, please. If you don't get anything, you got to get this tonight, okay? So the spirit is subject to you. You are not subject to the spirit regarding this. Come on, amen. Just like tongues. Or just like healing. If I said, all right, everyone who wants healing, come right now. In the name of Jesus, you'll be healed. I don't have to say, wait, I'm waiting for the gifts of healing right now. God wants to heal. Come on. Just like he wants us to speak in tongues. Why? The spirit is subject to the prophet. Not the prophet is subject to the spirit. But verse 31, what is he talking about? What is the understood subject in verse 31? Prophecy. Come on, right? So God is waiting for you to begin to prophesy. And the moment you begin to speak, come on, it'll come. When we used to live here in Florida, we used to live in Fort Lauderdale. We used to have an internship. Will you quietly put that song on? Just that soaking in the presence. And so as we used to live here in Fort Lauderdale, we used to have an internship. So we had young adults who came from all over America to come, and they would be an intern of our ministry, and we would train them for the ministry. Because I felt like most people were going to Bible school, and they were not really seeing what ministry really is. They were just hearing a lot of teaching, but they weren't really feeling the weight of what real ministry was. So we had young people from Wisconsin, Indiana, California, Minnesota, all over the country we had them. And so, but they would travel with us. And I remember we were ministering for, do you know Clyde Oliver up in Melbourne? You guys know him? He's an FCF guy. And so, we were up at Pastor Clyde's church. And so worship just got done. And so I turned to the one intern. She was from Indiana. I said to her, I said, Tara, I said, come here. She said, yes. I said, in 3 minutes, you're going to get up and do the offering. She said, no. I said, yes. I said, and you're going to share the word for 5 to 10 minutes on the offering. Oh, man. Okay. And I said, before you do that, you're going to give 3 accurate prophetic words and words of knowledge. She goes, oh, God. I mean, she like instantly went into prayer. I mean, God, Jesus. I mean, she was praying a house of fire, right? And then when it came time, whatever, 3-5 minutes later, Pastor Clyde went and called us up there. And so I said, go for it, Tara. And so she went on up there and she walked up and she grabbed the microphone. Boom, all of a sudden. And she gave those 3 prophetic words. And they were razor sharp. Come on, somebody. She was shocked herself. Come on, somebody. Amen. She was totally stunned. You know why? Because she realized she activated the Spirit. The Spirit did not activate her. Come on, everyone say, I activate the Spirit. Smith Wigglesworth used to say this. He said, God does what Smith does. If Smith does nothing, God does nothing. Come on, somebody. Amen. So I don't know who this word is for tonight, but I just felt like this was really to stir your heart tonight to hear the voice of God. The Spirit is subject to the prophet. Not the prophet is subject to the Spirit. And I don't know who that's for tonight, but I just really believe that God wants you to, by faith, begin to start to just go for some of these things like never before. Amen. That you just begin to use your faith. Just begin to say, all right, Lord, I want you to use me. And the moment you desire, you activate it. The moment you desire it, that's all God's looking for is desire. That's it. Just that little bit of desire. And it's all of a sudden like you activate the gifts of the Spirit. Amen. So all over the church here tonight, just raise your hands right now. Come on, just raise your hands. Come on, just pray in the Holy Ghost right now. Come on, just for the next few minutes. Tita maniato kolobaras. Sibiato koloverisa. Sibdiviata kalabados, asa katalabada namasa. Shibianto tolobondanamanka sakalaba. Dienzibio tokoloba. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Sakalabosha sasasia budala lamaya. Kambure nenamasa tetalabakesha stita talaveta sakesha stita tika sakalahara dananamadoso. Zingdivia to columbra. Lamia calabaras. Job devia to calabara nananamandusa. Teacha talabaketo. Lobra boduso kuvalara baradamadasa katara dadanamandishi. Zingdivita kolododa sokolovoda. Jingamatu kalava, bombrebede sikatika sakahala varadanomoso tala vadadisa. Come on, one more minute, just press in. Siamalova, ping debia talabayako sapabava, zimbeviendo, dumbre manasa. Lord, we worship you tonight. Fakalabas posho, holobrebes pasade, zingdevita ketika levacusa kara danamanduta talava. Bing debaniando, golomondondo rebambom badadongolo. Thank you, Jesus. Now, I had a vision. I saw in your church. I saw in this church, not in another church. I saw in this church. I saw two streams coming, one from this way and one come from this way. And the one coming from this way, I saw were young people, like youth and young adults and stuff. And then I saw another stream of people coming from this way, like bikers. And I just saw God was just going to start to just draw two total different streams into the same place. And Pastor John, I just felt that it's going to be the easiest thing. It's just going to be bam. It's just going to happen. It's just going to be the hand of the orchestration of the hand of God. And so thank you, Jesus. Amen. Come on. How many of you believe that? Anyone? Woo-hoo. Thank you, Jesus. Now, speaking of words of knowledge, there's some ladies here tonight that you've got some female problems and the Lord wants to heal you. You have physical pain from it. Who is that tonight? Is that you? Come right now. Thank you, Jesus. She's not the only one. There's one more. It's very painful. The Lord wants to heal you of that thing. I don't know who that is tonight. I don't sense that you've gone to the doctor, but just that thing hurts. If that's you, quickly come. You're in a safe place. You're in a safe place. Quickly come. Thank you, Jesus. Who is that tonight? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And then there's someone here tonight as well that you have something's wrong with you, like an electrical thing in your brain. I don't know what it is exactly, like this electrical thing. And just the Lord wants to bring you healing with that thing. I don't know what that is. I don't even know what that means. But there's something wrong with the electrical waves in your brain. Do you know who it is? Oh, he just stepped out? Okay. All right. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Now, I'll just tell you, okay, I'm just going to say it now, all right? I had none of those things when I started, okay? But I just said, all right, now I'm going to have a word of knowledge. So I'm not just like making it up, but I mean, I had nothing. I just said, all right, Lord, now you're going to give me a word of knowledge. Amen? And so the moment I did that, I activated it. You understand? And so now there is still another woman that you're supposed to be up here as well. And then this person, did he step out? He stepped out. Okay. That's all right. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Something with memory. I just keep getting memory. It's like a memory thing or something. I don't know what that is. But if there's anyone else, is it you too? Come. Come on up as well. All right. But something with electrical and the memory. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Just stand over by her. Thank you, Father, right now for your healing presence. Thank you for your healing presence today. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I've never had this before, but somebody in your teeth. You got something going wrong in your teeth, and the Lord wants to heal your teeth. I've never had. Is that you? Yeah. I thought it was someone back there. Okay. In your teeth. God wants to heal you. Come, brother. Yeah. We were in a church one time, and I had a weirdest word of knowledge. I said, there's a girl here, and you have an infected tongue. I mean, it was the main church of AFCM, Wilmer, Minnesota. Jim's original church. And this girl, 19-year-old girl, come crying and screaming, running down the front. And here she had gotten her tongue pierced and she got an infection. And it had swollen to 3 times its normal size. It looked like a cow tongue in her mouth. But God healed that girl just like that. Come on, amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I mean, we could just call everyone up for healing, but here we're talking about the voice of God. But in particular, man, I don't know what they even call that thing in the bottom of your foot. Causes you pain in the bottom of your foot. Lord, I don't even know what that thing is, but someone here tonight, you have something's wrong in the bottom of your foot. Causes you pain in the bottom of your... Is that you, sir? Yeah, come. come on up here as well. Yeah. What's that thing called? Planner's word. Yeah, it hurts all the time. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Thank you, Jesus. Awesome. Just lift your hands, Lord. Thank you for touching all of them right now in the name of Jesus. God, we thank you for healing them one by one. Right now, we just set them free. Right now, all the pain, go right now. We command it. Dry up right now in the name of Jesus. Be set free right now by God's grace. Be healed right now. Set you free here tonight in Jesus' name. Be healed right now. Be healed right now, brother, in Jesus' name. Be healed right now in the name of Jesus. Be healed right now. Feet be healed right now. All the pains go right now. All the pains go right now. Thank you, Jesus. All the pains go right now. We set you free by God's grace. Thank you, Father, right now. So let's do this. Just everyone else, just jump to your feet tonight. Thank you, Jesus. Would you do me a favor, brother? I've got some anointing oil. It's in those little bottles. You'll see it. All right. I want everyone to just jump out of your feet. Come on down here to the front. We just want to anoint you afresh for hearing God's voice, all right? So just take about 3 steps forward and thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Ushers, if you want to make a second line back there and just everyone come. Thank you, Father, right now in the name of Jesus. God, we give you praise. We give you thanks right now. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for your healing and your blessing tonight. Just stretch your hands right now toward heaven. Thanks, brother. Thanks. Appreciate it. Just turn it up. Just fill the house tonight. Come on, just soak in God's presence tonight. Come on, just pray in the Holy Ghost, just all over the house. In the name of Jesus. Lord, I pray right now for the sharpening of the voice of God. In the name of Jesus. Sharpening of their voice. Sharpening of the voice of Jesus. 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 In the name of Jesus. Sharpening of the voice of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, just tap in tonight. Jesus' name. Sharpening of the voice of Jesus. 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 The sharpening of the voice of Jesus. The sharpening of the voice of Jesus. The sharpening of the voice of Jesus. Lord, I pray right now over them both right now in the name of Jesus. Use it right now, Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus. Cabo solo bodo mara de marca sabatica sicistoro bala. In the name of Jesus. The sharpening of the voice of Jesus. Lord, I thank you right now. Presence of Jesus. Presence of Jesus. Presence of Jesus, presence of Jesus, presence of Jesus, presence of Jesus, presence of Jesus. Come, Holy Spirit, coming, come, Holy Spirit, presence of Jesus, presence of Jesus, presence of Jesus, presence of Jesus. Open their ears to hear, Lord, I pray right now. Open their ears, open our ears to hear, Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus. Opening the ears to hear. just take the next few minutes. Just wait on the Lord. Just don't say anything. Just wait in His presence. Just wait on Him tonight. Shh. You to do. Thank you, Father. Ladies, I want you to find a lady, one person. Men, I want you to find a man. Just go for it, right? And then I just want you to minister to that person, all right? Don't make a string, but just one person, grab both their hands. One person. Ladies, find a lady. Men, find a man, grab both their hands, all right? And you're going to pray for them for the next few minutes. And then if God speaks something to your heart, just ask them, all right? Just go for it right now. Just pray for them right now. Lord, I just pray right now, a blessing on them right now, whatever. Just go for it. Just by faith. Just by faith. Lord, I bless them. I speak blessing. I speak encouragement. Word over them. Just pray for them. Just pray blessing on them. Have a prophetic word, just share it with them. Man, this is what I sense. This is what I see. This is what I feel. Just one more minute.
If you've finished ministering to each other, those of you that are still ministering to each other, please feel free, continue. But for the rest of you, maybe you're finished, just stir yourself in the Holy Ghost and pray some more in the Holy Ghost. Nasivia kata badadavasu, letia pasafariati sutu shapara madabaya. Just join hands with somebody near you if you're finished, and just join hands with the people around you. Just pray in the Holy Ghost in a real nice unity with each other. Nasavana batuze pendivi kifi ala la massa. Nitia sampatia katabakia devikia. Y'all link up hands and just begin to pray. Su refitia pasafaka Nende vedia la lava sambarra mando curi vidivisifia. Hala la massifia cante vetissa. Pondo to shunne breva da mande vengende bondu bata fasifi. Nimbo su repanda fande visifi andi a kifu. Masu jefrefe a tai le kife alla matassa. Ne kiria panda vetimbro botus panda vekisha revidivisa. Ne vondo bosu remedivisa vala massifumukusa. Halala kisa, nishotusa fediatai. Mendivikushukure vitifia tadadavataya. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Ne sifia kambala lava sifia tavaka papa panda vendeviti sifia. Ne kuri bidia vasifia la la massifikishuku. Mende vromondo yo su remendivina mandavala le kiti ala lavasa. Nesu yoku shuku revidiviki diatabai. Sunti ashataya. Well, you've spoken words over each other and somebody else in the room. Speak words over yourself. Prophesy to yourself for a moment. Encourage yourself in the Lord. Just interpret your own prayer from what you were praying and speak to yourself. Hallelujah. 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 Glory to you, Jesus. Glory to you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Well, may tonight mark a new day, a new night. Hallelujah. For you. Glory to God. Glory to God. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Lord, as we sleep tonight, I ask that you reveal some of the things that you've done in us by the Spirit. Things have happened tonight inside of us that we may not know, but you'll reveal them, many of those things, to us tonight. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Yeah, I may not have seen and ear may not have heard, but you've revealed it to us by your Spirit. Father, we thank you that the things of the Spirit are not concealed from us, but they're revealed to us. Hallelujah. You've opened the eyes of our understanding. You've given us light. You allow us glimpses into the spirit realm. And so our eyes are open, our ears are open. Thank you for sharpening us tonight, for teaching us by the Holy Ghost, and for helping us to find the right frequency, to tune in. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Well, I was blessed tonight. Glory to God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Sheila? She's going to come up. Okay, y'all just got to hear this real quick because this is cool. Now, she never said any of this in church, but was it care group? Where was it? Where
no,
you were?
It was here.
Leader, it was in the leaders' meeting. So a few Sundays ago, you saw a vision in the middle of service.
Yeah, it was the week before Mother's Day, and there was fire coming out of those two white boxes, whatever they are. And they didn't come down. The fire didn't come down. And I kept asking the Lord, what's this all about? But he's never told me anything until tonight. And he said, it's the beginning of this weekend.
Amen.
The tons of fire. It's the beginning. That was the beginning of this weekend. So expect.
Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Some of our leaders that are here, you remember her sharing that in leaders meeting? She said, I don't know what it means. But anyway, so praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. All right. Bless you, Lord. Bless you, Lord. Bless you, Jesus. Now, you can go home from here and just say, oh, I heard a lot of good stuff. I got some notes, you know. Or you can put it into practice. If you don't put it into practice, it just stays on paper. It just stays in your head. But if you put it into action, it'll spread through the earth. And it'll affect change in you and in whoever it is that the Lord brings you to. So if you stop somewhere tonight, maybe to get something to eat or gas or whatever. Or maybe when you get home, I don't know, just step on out. Step on out, prophesy to somebody. And it doesn't have to be sophisticated, it can be simple. Sometimes the simples are the betters. So anyway, all right. Well, Brother Tom left the room, so he said we're good. Oh, he's at his table. Hey, we'll see you tomorrow morning. Hopefully you can be here tomorrow morning at 10 a.m. And then for tomorrow night as well. Bless you, bless you, bless you.
You're not right when he told you you're not strong enough to put up a good fight, when he told you you're not worthy, when he told you you're not loved, when he told you you're not beautiful, you'll never be enough.